Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Rita Choudhury from the Department of Ancient Indian History and Culture, University of Calcutta. I am the head and the associate professor of this department. The topic today, subject today is Indian culture, and the paper is on social and cultural history of India. I'll be discussing the indigenous sources for the study of social history. So we have our learning objectives are many. We have to investigate the indigenous sources of history, because I want to tell you at this moment that we do not have any specific text which highlight the social history of India. So we have to look through and sift evidence from various sources such as Brahminical literature, Buddhist Jain literature, Sangam literature, scientific works, inscriptions, numismatics, and miscellaneous sources, the last three constituting archaeological sources of India. Now, all historical evidences are based on some kind of sources, and for the history of early India, we have literary and archaeological sources. The rigid distinction is not always found everywhere, because all of these materials, literature and archaeology, constitute the whole material substance that we require to analyze the history of India. So what I want to say is that all Indian historiography began in literary tradition. They are not just historical works. We do not find exact historical works regarding the early history of India. We have to depend mostly on kinds of work which were written following the literary traditions, and we have to prize out history from these sources. Now I will be going on to the sources that we need to study. First of all, we go to Brahminical literature, which consists of, first of all, we analyze Vedic literature. These consist of the Rig Veda, the Yajur Veda, the Sam Veda, and the Atharva Veda. Now going to the Rig Veda, we have references to the settlement of the Rig Vedic Aryans in the Saptashindova area, which was watered by the Indus and its eastern and western tributaries, as well as the Saraswati, which is now lost. Now, they were mainly a pastoral people, and we do not find a reference to the agriculture at this stage. These, we must remember at this stage, that most of the literature that we are analyzing contain interpolations which were added at a much later period. So it is references to agriculture comes only in the latest stratum of the Rig Veda. Now as we go on, we are regarding social history, our most important aspect is the caste system. In the Rig Veda, in the Purusha Sukta hymn of the Rig Veda, we find the first references to the social divisions. But we must remember that these divisions were not as rigid as we see at a later period. We do not find any reference to Brahmanas, Vaishyas, Kshatriyas, and Shudras. That comes only in the later period, in the later Sangitas, like the Samaveda, the Yajur Veda, and the Atharva Veda. The Brahmanas explain the meaning of the sacrifices and methods of performing them. As literary sources, they actually provide an idea about the expansion of the Aryans. There are several Brahmanas, the names of which have been given in the slide. Now, the essence of the Brahminical text is that they provide an excellent picture of the social, religious, and economic development of the later Vedic age. Then we have the Aranyakas, which are known as forest texts because they were written in the forest, and they deal with mysticism and philosophy and not with rituals, which is an important development of the Aryans. So we have important Aranyakas which have been attached to different Brahmanas. And the names of some of them are Brihad Aranyaka, Taittiriya Aranyaka. We go on to the Upanishads. Now the Upanishads have preserved ancient Indian philosophical knowledge. The knowledge has been originally imparted to the people while they were sitting near the teacher. It was therefore a confidential communication between the teacher and the people, and the secret doctrine or rahasya, meaning concerning the creator and the created individual. Important Aranyakas as literary sources, which we can use as sources of social history, are Isha, Kena, Katha, Mundako, Mandukya, Kaushitaki, Chandogya, Brihadaranyaka, and Taittiriya Upanishads. Now, last part of the Vedic literature consists of the Vedangas, which conclude the Vedic literature, and they consist of six parts. They like Shiksha or phonetics, Kalpa or rituals, Vyakaran or grammar, Nirukta or etymology, Chanda or metrics, and Jyotish or astronomy. Now, about the Sutras. The Sutras literally mean text, thread. The word Sutra literally means thread. But here we find they are manuals of instructions for the lay people. The Sutras consist of three texts, Sutra, Grijya Sutra, and the Dharma Sutras. Now, important among these for the study of social history are the Grijya Sutras, which give us the domestic, which tell us about domestic religious ceremonies which the laymen have to follow. Next, we have the Sriti texts, which are literary works which not only record religious activities and principles, but also provide various guidelines pertaining to social economic life and state management. For instance, ancient Indian rulers were guided by the Sritis while providing justice to their subjects in accordance with the Hindu tradition. Prominent authors of the Sritis are Monu, Jagyobalka, Narad, Brihaspati, Kattayan, Parashara, and Deval. Of all the Sritis, Monu Sriti is most important literary work as it provides an insight into the rigidity of the caste system and other aspects of Hindu social life. In addition to the original Sritis, most of them had commentaries written on them at a later period. Now, I would like to mention that the Sritis were continuously added on from time to time, and we cannot confine them within a definite period. Next, we have the epics, which are important sources of history in general and social history in particular. The Mahabharata was written by Vedavyasa, consisted of 8,800 verses in its original form. Initially, it was named Jaya, meaning victory, but later the verses were raised to 24,000 in number and named after a popular tribe, Bharat. It took its final form between 4000 BCE and 400 CE when it became a compilation of 1 lakh verses with three portions: narrative, descriptive, and instructive. The narrative portion is related to the Kaurava-Pandava conflict, which occurred during the later Vedic phase. The descriptive portion is related to the post-Vedic times. The instructive portion stretches to the post-Maurya, to the Gupta period. The Ramayana, written by Maharshi Valmiki, consisted of 6,000 verses in its original form. Later, 6,000 more verses were added to it. The final compilation appeared with 24,000 verses. It took its final form between 200 BCE and 200 CE and related the story of the achievements of the ideal king of Ayodhya, Ramchandra. As a literary source, the theory of kingship, victory in the name of truth, the doctrine of tolerance, the kingdom of Videho, and Ram's popularity are some of the important elements in this story. The Puranas are important source of ancient Indian history, are ancient volumes of the Hindus written in Sanskrit. They are 18 in number, and each Puran is divided into 5 parts. They are very important as a literary source as they give dynastic histories from 400 BCE up to the beginning of the Gupta rule. The Vishnu Puran, the Vayu Puran, Brahma Puran are very significant from the historical point of view. The Matsya Puran, the Bhagavat Puran, the Agni Puran and the Shiva Puran, the Markandeya Puran are also useful as literary sources. Now, here I want to add a little bit on this, is that the Puranas were originated very early in oral tradition. They were completed by the Gupta period, most of them. But in the 13th century, we have two Puranas, the Brihad Dharma Puran and the Brahma Vaivarta Puran, which give us interesting aspects of social history, in that they refer to numerous jatis that emerged during this period. Now we go on to biographical works or Charit Kavyas, which do not always provide genuine history of ancient India. However, they are helpful in constructing an authentic account of the period. Important amongst them are Banabhatta's Harshacharit, Bakpochdi's Gaudavaha, Vilhana's Vikramanka Devacharit, Chandakarnandi's Ramacharit, and Himchandra's Kumarpalcharit. Amongst the chronicles, which also provide us important information on historical events, we have Kalhan's Rajtarangini, which was written in the 12th century, but gives us authentic history from the 7th century onwards. Amongst the other notable chronicles are the Rajamala from Gujarat and the Kirti Komodi from Nepal. We have Shastras on politics and grammar, like the Arthashastra of Kautilya, which is regarded as a unique literary work in the Mauryan period. It helps in reconstructing the history of the Mauryas, deals with the principles of administration, explains the conduct of the king, and also throws light on the socio-economic institutions that governed law and order at that time. Niti Shastra of Kamandaka is another significant literary work on politics written in the Gupta period. Ashtadhyayi of Panini, an important work on grammar, also gives a valuable description of the non-monarchical form of government. Mahabhashya of Patanjali is a commentary on Ashtadhyayi, which also gives a vivid description of the Greek invasions of the time. Amarkosh of Amarsingha is in the nature of a dictionary or encyclopedia. We come to creative literature, which consists of poetry, drama, narrative works, which form a large section of ancient Indian literary works and reflect on contemporary social, cultural and political conditions. Therefore, they are important source material for constructing the ancient past. In this context, the notable literary works are Raghuvamsa by Kalidas, which describes the expedition of King Samudragupta, Shudraka's Mitchukotikam, which unravels the social and political conditions of North India during Gupta period and depicts women's position in society. Mudra Rakshasa of Vishakhadatta describes vividly the war between King Nanda and Chandragupta Maurya, which has also been described by Kautilya. Kalidasa's Malavikagni Mitram narrates about the defeat of the Greeks on the banks of the Indus. We come to a very important source of ancient Indian history, the Buddhist literature. Now, the Pitakas are the most important of the Buddhist canonical literature. They describe the principles of Buddhism in Pali language and consists of three divisions: Vinaya Pitak, Shuddha Pitak, Abhidhamma Pitak, meaning conduct, sermon and metaphysics. Among these, the Shuddha Pitak is the most important, which is a collection of Buddha's religious teachings and thoughts. It is divided into five Nikayas: Digha meaning long, Majjhima meaning medium, Samyukta meaning connected, Anguttara meaning graduated, and Khuddaka meaning small, which also includes the Jatakas. The Jatakas are a very important source of history for us because it contains the previous stories regarding the previous birth of the Buddha and various other aspects have been described, important, which are important for this as sources of Indian history. Now, there are also other Buddhist literature written in Pali language which give ample information about contemporary society. Incidentally, it is from these literary works that we have learnt about Ashoka, Kanishka, Pushyamitra Shunga and Chandragupta Maurya. Notable are the following works: Milinda Panho, containing dialogues between the Greek king Menander and the Buddhist saint Nagasen; Deepavamsa and Mahavamsa, describing the history of Sri Lanka and India from the 6th century to the 4th century BC. Books written by Nagarjuna, Shatashahasrika Pragya Paramita and Madhyamika Sutra, the book Mahajana Sutra written by Asanga, and the book Abhidhamma Kosha written by Vasubandhu gives us valuable descriptions of the society. We have also Jain literature. The Jain literature was originally written in Prakrit language and consisted of Angas and Upangas. These works impart the teachings of Lord Mahavir and are of great value in the reconstruction of ancient Indian history. However, from an historical point of view, Parishishta Parvan, written by Hemachandra, is vital as it refers to the royal origin of Chandragupta Maurya. Bhagavati Sutra provides an insight into the 16 Mahajana Padas. The Bhadrabahu Charita cites several events during the reign of Chandragupta Maurya. The 6th century BC, when we find where we use the Buddhist and Jain literature, has been considered to be a watermark in Indian history, because this was the time when we find that various reformatory movements were going on, and what we call Protestant movements among the Buddhists and the Jains. Now, here, during this time, we find changes in the society which has been reflected in Buddhist literature. The thought process, the different thought process, the difference in the organization of society from what there was in the Brahminical time. In the Brahminical times, we cannot say, in the Brahminical epoch. So there was a difference that we witness in the Buddhist literature. This was the time where we get information of how they divided the society into not as Brahmins, Kshatriyas, Vaishyas and Shudras, but only as Utkatta and Hino. Utkatta meaning high and Hino meaning low. Then we get new information about a new group of people called the Gahapatis, who sometimes scholars have considered them to be Vaishyas because they were mainly dependent on land. But these were a wealthy section of the society who helped in the spread of Buddhism. Now, we find also importance being given to Kula, Karma and Shilpa, meaning the family, Karma meaning profession and Shilpa meaning craft. So this was a different kind of society that they were trying to depict. We have the Pitakas, as I have told you. Now, and from there, the Pitakas, especially the Shutka Pitakas, I have told you about the Jatakas. The Jatakas contain folk tales, so they reflect on the society in a very expansive manner. So we have this all this new kind of ideas coming in from the Buddhist literature. Now, equally important is the Jaina literature, which also depict a society which they try to depict a very different kind of society. But we must remember also that it is not that they don't discriminate amongst people. Even in Jaina literature, we have about a distinction between who were the highly placed people and who were lowly in society. So, we should not make a mistake while reading this kind of literature that they were entirely different. The idea that they were high and low among the people, this distinction also remained even in the Jaina literature. we find some of the titles that have been given about regarding the people. They, we find though some of them are also relevant even today, but they mostly belong to the higher stratum of society. So this distinction remained whatever literature that we study. The importance on purity of blood, the higher echelons of society was still there. Then we have Sangam literature. This is written in Tamil language. The Sangam literature was compiled by several poets patronized by rulers during a period of 400 years. The entire work consists of 88 anthologies called Ettutukai. Nearly 30,000 lines of poetry are arranged in groups of 100. The value of these texts lies in the fact that they gave a clear picture of the principal dynasties of ancient South India, like the Chera, Cholas and the Pandyas. But apart from Sangam literature, we also have the Tolkappiyam, which is a great grammatical work, and the Monimekulai, which is an epic. These are very important for the reconstruction of the society during the time that they depict. We have scientific works. In the field of mathematics and astronomy, the works of Aryabhatta named Aryabhatiya and Brahmagupta's named Shuddha Siddhanto are unique because it provides proof that ancient Indians were pioneers in scientific research in these fields. Varahamihira's Brihat Sanhita is also an important contribution in this respect. In the field of medical science, Charak Sanhita and Shushruta Sanhita are notable literary works. In the field of agricultural science, Krishi Parasharo dealing with agriculture and Vriksha Ayurveda dealing with knowledge of trees are useful literary contributions. In the field of architecture, we have the Manasollaso written by King Someshwara, which is a noteworthy work. I have talked about a whole lot of literary sources that we use for the study of ancient Indian society and all the other aspects also. But we must remember that since they do not depict, most of them, especially the early texts, are essentially religious in nature, they do not depict the society or the economy as it existed in those times. I have already told you that we have to price out the evidence from these sources. Naturally, there are gaps. We need supportive evidence in this regard. Now, that is why we use archaeological sources. In this case, we have inscriptions which, because they have been engraved on stone and metal, cannot be tampered on, unlike literary sources, and therefore they are a source of highest value during the construction of ancient history. The earliest form of inscriptions are the edicts of Ashok, which have been found from beyond the Indus in the west to Mysore Plateau in the south. As records, these edicts provide knowledge of the period and of Ashoka, an unique monarch the world has ever known. Prashastis or eulogies of kings written by the court poets on stone slabs and pillars have been used for gathering historical knowledge about society and economy. Land grants engraved on copper plates throw considerable light on the socio-economic condition of the period concerned. Next, we have numismatics. Apart from inscriptions, coins have been by far the most important archaeological source in reconstruction ancient Indian history. Fortunately, hordes of coins have been unearthed and individual specimens are still being found at excavation sites. Coins have been the only source of information regarding the Greeks, Chalcos, Parthians in the post-Mojo era. Likewise, information of the Kushans have been gathered due to the issue of a large number of coins. The information regarding the existence of various states, both monarchical and republic, have been exclusively gathered from these coins. The Gupta dynasty issued a large number of coins which form an additional source of information of early history, early Indian history. Regarding archaeological sources, we include inscriptions, numismatics and various other miscellaneous finds that we get from excavations and explorations. Now, inscriptions, coins, they help us to fill in many of the gaps that we find in the literary sources, because the literary sources do not always give us all the symmetrical description of the times that they describe. And being there being a lot of interpolations, we cannot place the time span within which they were written. And they do not highlight the exact information about contemporary society. But inscriptions can be securely dated, as well as numismatics in most of the cases. So we have very concrete evidence about the times they were speaking of. Now we have miscellaneous sources. Archaeological sources are also those relics which are of miscellaneous character. That is, they do not fall within the broad category of inscriptions and numismatics. Such antiquarian remains are buildings, temples, statues of stones and metals, terracotta, ornamental and decorative fragments, pottery. These relics have considerably contributed towards a proper appreciation of the life and spirit of ancient India. About the miscellaneous sources, we get a vast variety of finds from excavations and explorations, like beads, pottery, terracotta images, stone images, and ruins of buildings also, which help us to reconstruct the kind of life and society that people lived in. And along with that, we can highlight the spirit of the civilization that existed in ancient India. Now, from what I have told you, I have tried to give you a comprehensive idea of the sources that we can use for the study of early Indian culture and society. Now, it is not that we get a very symmetrical idea from all the sources that we have gathered. I have told you that we have to use literary and archaeological evidence, since the literature does not give us a whole idea about the period concerned. Now, archaeological evidence has helped us to corroborate and support all the evidences that we find from literature. Now, what archaeology has done is to provide newer evidence. From literature, we get whatever evidence we can gather, but archaeology has helped us to find newer evidence, newer sources that can help us to prove what we are trying to visualize. So I hope that I have been able to explain to you the importance of the indigenous sources for the study of ancient Indian social and cultural history. Thank you.